Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar in Oval Vaccination and Hatchery Management. My name is Gert De Lange and I'm Senior Poultry Specialist at Royal Pastry Farm. It's great to be speaking with all of you today. Before I start my presentation, I have a few housekeeping items to cover about this presentation and the Royal Pastry Farm webinar platform. There will be a few polls in which I invite you to give your opinion. You are invited to ask questions through the chat function. As much as possible, these will be answered in the chat during the webinar. If there are too many questions and time for answering these during the webinar is too short, you will receive my reply by email in the coming few days. So let's get started with the presentation. The contents of this webinar is as follows. First, I will explain a little bit about the why in oval vaccination. And what I would like to mention already up front, I am not going to talk about all the kinds of vaccines that are available and about how the immune response is working and about all the technologies that are available. It's just a general introduction. Then I would like to mention shortly the critical success factors, and the biggest part of this presentation is dealing with the implications for hatchery management. So first of all, why in oval vaccination? And maybe before we even talk about the why, what is inoval vaccination? It is a quite long definition, as you can see on the slide, but what basically is done is to deliver a vaccine inside an egg with an embryo in the late stage of development. And the aim is to target specific sites where the vaccine is capable of stimulating an immune response. We can also say inoval vaccination is a mass vaccination of individual embryos. And inoval vaccination can also be seen as an alternative. We know in hatcheries, day-old vaccinations are being given, as can be seen, for example, subcutaneous or intramuscular vaccination by injection, or spray vaccination, or farm vaccinations are also an option. By spray vaccination or, for example, by drinking water vaccination. And drinking water vaccination, as an example, could be Gumboro disease. But inoval vaccination could be an alternative for all these vaccinations. It's an excellent alternative for farm vaccinations. But it is also a good alternative for day-old vaccinations in the hatchery. First of all, because it gives an earlier protection and a better disease prevention. Because we are not waiting for day olds to vaccinate, but we already do it 3 days earlier, around the transfer time, let's say around day 18. Also, because we do it not with the day old chicks, but we do it with the embryos inside the egg, we provide less stress to the animals, and less stress means automatically that the immune response will be better. Also, a very big advantage of inoval vaccination is that you only have to train a few people. Just a few operators should be trained rather than an entire crew of people doing, for example, subcutaneous vaccination, or people in farms, many customers who have to do their own drinking water vaccinations. Also, the capacity of inoval vaccination is quite high. By the automatic systems that are available, we can go even to as much as 60,000 eggs per hour. And if inoval vaccination is done correctly, we have a better application of the expensive vaccine compared to the traditional methods. And last but not least, there are more and more vaccines available, even combination vaccines like HVT, Newcastle disease, and infectious bursal disease. Okay, inoval vaccination, to make it successful, we have to study the few critical success factors. And important is to realize that we do this to get an immune response, a good immune response. And for that, it is important that the vaccine is being delivered at the correct site inside the egg. And also, of course, a good vaccine, a vaccine that is capable to get an immune response, is important. But that one, as I mentioned before, will not be discussed. Also, we do not want to reduce hatchability. Basically, what we do is to punch a hole in the eggshell. But what we do not want to achieve is to kill the embryo or to cause contamination, leading to a reduced hatchability. So these are some objectives of in ovo vaccination. And what then are the critical success factors? First of all, let's talk about the egg location. And the vaccine has to be delivered at the proper place inside the egg. And this is related to egg setting and also to the type of setter tray that's being used. Then the shell needs to be penetrated. That is an important aspect, but I will not further on discuss it. The site of the injection, where exactly the vaccine needs to be delivered, is related to the embryo age as well as to the uniformity of embryo development. The vaccine needs to be delivered. And the last important factor that determines success rate is the sanitation, which is related again to egg and hatchery hygiene. So I will not discuss all of these in detail, but number 1, 3, and 5 will be the main topic of this presentation. The site of injection is very crucial. There are a few sites where we do not want to deliver the vaccine, because simply if you deliver the vaccine in the air cell or in the allantoic sac, that's where all the blood vessels are situated, just beneath the eggshell, or in the yolk sac, there will be absolutely no immune response. And that is not the aim of the in ovo vaccination. If you want to get a good immune response, there are only two good places where the vaccine should be delivered, and that is either in the embryo itself, subcutaneous or intramuscular, or in the amniotic sac. To be able to reach that proper site of vaccination, it is very important that the timing is correct. And that means that the embryo should be in the phase of development, that the embryo is in the proper position to hatch. As you can see, it means head under the right wing. And also important is that the staak of the yolk sac is entering into the abdomen. And important, last but not least, is that not too many embryos have started external pipping. A maximum of 1 to 2% external pipping is allowed. The questions that arise now is, what is then the optimal incubation time to do this in ovo vaccination? And is this incubation time, this optimal incubation time, equal or is it not equal to embryo age? Those questions will be answered during this presentation. So the site of injection is important, as mentioned, and this is related to the embryo age, or we can even say maybe better, the embryo stage. Talking about age, the vaccination window is approximately after 17 and a half till 19 and a quarter days of incubation. But actually, what is far more important, what is at that moment the embryo stage? So not the embryo age, but the embryo stage. What is the embryo development stage score? You see in this diagram that when we are in embryo stage 1 or 2, that quite a bit of vaccine is being delivered in either the allantoic sac, the air cell, or in the yolk sac. So stage 1 and 2 is actually not a good moment to do the in ovo vaccination, because those places of injection will not give an immune response. What we need to do is to vaccinate in ovo with embryos at least being in stage 3 up till 5. 6 and 7 is already too late. Let me explain how we come to this embryo scoring system. And I have to mention that this scoring system is being used by one of the players in the in ovo vaccination industry. So this is not a pass reform invention, but this I'm using it simply as an example to show that embryo age is less important than embryo stage. The stage score is being determined by looking to two aspects. One is the head position of the embryo to check the position of the head, or maybe the embryo already has internally pipped or externally pipped. And the other aspect to study is the rate of yolk sac absorption. Looking to the head position part, if we see after we take a sample of eggs at the moment of transfer and the required moment of doing the in-ovo vaccination, that the head is under the wing, we give such an embryo 1 point. If internal pipping is already starting, that means the beak of the air cell is piercing into the membrane and into the air cell, we give 2 points, and if externally pipping has started, we give 3 points. This is one part of the scoring system. The other part of the scoring system is the yolk sac absorption rate. If the intestines are still visible into the yolk stalk, we give 1 point. And actually, I can already mention, in such a situation, it is too early to do in-ovo vaccination. And then we give 2 points when we see that the yolk shows two lobes, and by the time the yolk is starting to really enter the body, no more lobes at all being visible, we give 3 points, and when it is fully absorbed, 4 points are being given. And those two scoring systems are actually added together. So let's take an example of a stage 3 embryo. You see that this stage 3 embryo has 1 point for an embryo where the head is under the wing, and 2 points for the B-lobe yolk sac makes a total of 3. And this is, as we have seen in the previous diagram, a good embryo for in-ovo vaccination. The other one in the bottom, stage 6, you see it already external pipping has started, 3 points. Also the yolk is almost entering the body, is almost completely going in. That's another 3 points. This makes an embryo of stage 6. And that is actually a little bit too late to do in-ovo vaccination. So the vaccination window, 17.5 till 19.25 day of incubation, is what we are aiming for, but it is more important to check what is at this moment that you want to do the in-ovo vaccination, the embryo development stage, and it should be at least 3 or more, and preferably not 6 and 7, because that's a bit too late. So this is something important to keep in mind. So now the major part of this presentation is what are the implications for hatchery management. The implications for hatchery management, I have divided them in 3 bullets, and I will discuss them one by one. First of all, the egg and hatchery hygiene. What I will not discuss, but it is also relevant, is the needle design and the sanitation during the in-ovo vaccination process. That of course plays also a role. Another part I will discuss is about egg grading and the position of the egg on the setter tray. And also a very important item is, are all the embryos in the same stage, or do we see a lot of difference in embryo staging? Let's first talk about egg and hatchery hygiene. The egg normally is a very well protective layer. It has a very well organized defense system, I should say, to keep the embryo free from pathogens and from infection. But when we do in-ovo vaccination, we are making a hole in the eggshell, and actually we are breaching the defense system of the egg. So there is a big risk that airborne infection will occur. For example, if there's a high rate of fungus spores in the hatchery, fungus could enter through this hole in the egg and could cause damage to the embryo. Also, bacteria from the humidifiers, for example, inside the hatcher, can cause issues of airborne infection. And what if there are eggs exploding, bangers, during the transfer process or in the hatcher itself? Of course, we have to make sure that we remove these exploders as much as we can, even before we do the in-ovo vaccination. And with the modern technology that we have nowadays, not only doing kenneling by light, but also trying to detect heartbeat, we can take these exploders out before we actually do the in-ovo vaccination. Some aspects of egg hygiene which are relevant. Floor eggs. What to do with floor eggs? If you want to do in-ovo vaccination, egg hygiene is very relevant, very important. So we should consider, or maybe even not to even set floor eggs at all, because they are a risk factor. And the same goes for eggs with cracks. When you set eggs with hairline cracks, of course the success rate of these eggs is lower. But when we do in-ovo vaccination, these eggs also pose a risk as they could easily be contaminated. So nest hygiene is very, very relevant. We have to make sure that the eggs are being produced in a clean environment. Sweating of eggs, which will happen when we take eggs from a cold storage room to a warm egg setter room, and we see condensation of water on the eggshell. This will allow pathogens to enter through the pores inside the egg, which is absolutely an unwanted situation when you are aiming for in-ovo vaccination. Also important is a good egg disinfection protocol. So these aspects of egg hygiene, they should be very well in order if you want to do in-ovo vaccination, and they require a lot of attention. Then the general hatchery hygiene, also an important aspect. We have to take that always serious, even when you do not do in-ovo vaccination. But when we do in-ovo vaccination, hatchery hygiene becomes even more important. And there are three main aspects that we have to study. First of all, vector management, which means we should avoid as much as possible that microorganisms, pathogens, enter inside our hatchery building. For example, we have to filter the air in the air handling unit. We have to minimize the number of visitors and people who come in, should wear company clothing, should take a shower, etc. Second part of hygiene, we have to avoid cross-contamination. For example, we have to avoid that fluff from the hatches will spread through the setter and cause problems over there. And of course, we cannot keep the hatchery free of microorganisms, so we have to have a good cleaning and disinfection protocol in place. All important aspects to make in-ovo vaccination a success. Egg grading and position is another important aspect of hatchery management. We should only set clean eggs. Dirty eggs should not be set in case you want to do in-ovo vaccination. Also, eggs with hairline cracks, those eggs are most likely contaminated with microorganisms. They should not be used when in-ovo vaccination is being practiced. Very important is that the eggs are being incubated sharp and down. This is of course important for normal incubation, but for in-ovo vaccination it's even more relevant. And the eggs should be upright position on the setter tray. Sometimes you have the situation where setter trays are being turned, eggs are being turned during incubation in the first 18 days. And it can happen that an egg stays in slant position and is being vaccinated, in-ovo vaccinated, when it is still in a slant position. This is not good. The egg should really be well supported, standing in an upright position. So a good design of the setter tray, keeping the eggs in the upright position, is very relevant. Here you see an experiment that was done by one of our customers to look to the effect of when you incubate eggs with a sharp end up without in-ovo vaccination. And you see that in this case the hatch of fertile is negative by 21%. So 21% drop of hatch of fertile. But what if we do in-ovo vaccination? Then it is even worse. Another customer did an experiment, very small scale experiment, just with a few setter trays. The results were as follows. When eggs were incubated, sharp and up, without in-ovo vaccination, hatch of fertile was 60%. And when in-ovo vaccination was practiced in this position, the hatch of fertile dropped down to 25%. So a dramatic result. So it's very, very important that when you want to do a novel vaccination, that you start incubation process with the eggs very clearly with the sharp end down and the air cell on top. As I have explained, we have to drop the vaccine at the proper position inside the egg, either in the amnion or in the embryo itself. And for that, it is important that the embryos are in the proper stage. And the question is now, is incubation time equal to the age of the embryo? Or could it be that embryos are developing faster or slower than the incubation time is suggesting? Which factors do play a role? Well, first of all, it could be the way the egg has been cooled down in the breeder farm. If eggs are cooling down really fast in the breeder farm, that means that an embryo in the storage room is less developed than an embryo that cooled down slowly and gradually to below 25 centigrades. So even in your egg storage room, if you have ununiform cooling processes, some eggs are cooling down fast, some are cooling down slow, we can also see differences of embryo staging at a fixed moment during the incubation process. Egg storage time. When eggs are being stored longer, incubation time will increase. So that means also that embryo staging at day 18 is less when an egg has been stored for a long time. Other factors that play a role is breed, egg size in relation to heat up time. To warm up a setter full of big eggs will go much slower than warming up a setter with small eggs. And also, incubation temperature itself has a big effect on the speed of development. So we have to keep in mind that there could be variation between, but also within batches of eggs. So the speed of cooling down from 41 centigrades to below 25 centigrades determines the embryo stage at start of incubation. So we have to keep in mind, is it, for example, a rollaway nest we have to deal with, where the eggs cool down potentially very fast, or is it a manual collected litter nest where eggs will cool down a bit slower? And are the eggs cooling down on pulp trays, paper trays, or are they cooling down on setter trays? On setter trays, there is more airflow around the eggs, and cooling down will occur faster and also more uniform. So the embryo stage of the eggs in your storage room, what you want is to have them as uniform as possible, so that all the embryos will start incubation from the same starting point. But also you want to have within all the batches in your hatchery, more or less the same speed, the same embryonic development, such that day 18 for every batch of eggs is corresponding to the same stage of embryonic development. In this slide, you see the effect of egg storage. You see the egg in the middle is stored for 4 days, and the two eggs on the side left and right from the middle, those eggs have been stored for 14 days, and we did incubate them for just 2.5 days to open them to show you the difference in blood vessel development, the area vasculosa. A short stored egg is developing much faster. So if we want to vaccinate stage 3 embryos, which is normally around day 18 of incubation, this might not be the case when you are dealing with long stored eggs. Then you might have to delay your in-ovo vaccination moment to a later time to reach the same embryo stage 3. We can, of course, take some procedures, management protocols to affect the incubation time of long stored eggs. We can talk about this heat treatment of eggs during storage, also called often SPIDES, short periods of incubation during egg storage. We do this heat treatment of eggs during storage to take away the negative effects of egg storage. And one of the negative effects of egg storage is that the incubation time will increase. And by heating up the eggs for a certain period above 90 Fahrenheit, for example, for 3.5 till 5 hours over 90 Fahrenheit, we can bring back the incubation time to the normal incubation time of non-stored eggs, such that we do not have to play around with the moment of in-ovo vaccination. It's important that all the embryos develop as uniform as possible, because temperature is the driving force behind embryo development. And the more we can keep the temperature of all the eggs in the setter at the same temperature, the more uniform the batch of embryos will be, and the more uniform the embryos will be at the moment of in ovo vaccination. What can we do to make this uniform development in the setter possible? One of the important items is to do a proper preheating. Before we start incubation, in the time before that, we should bring the eggs as much as close to the physiological zero. And we could debate if that is 25 or 27 centigrades, 77 or 81 Fahrenheit. But we are nowadays suggesting to do the preheating to 27 centigrades, 81 Fahrenheit, for approximately 5, 6, 7, 8 hours before actually starting incubation program. This will help to reach the incubation temperature eventually for all the eggs much more uniform, such that all the embryos start developing from the same moment onwards. And this will help also to have uniform embryo staging at the moment of in ovo vaccination. The design of the setter should allow uniform development. So what's important is a big heating surface, a big cooling surface, but also sufficient airflow over the eggs to keep the eggshell temperature or embryo temperature as uniform as possible. What we should try to avoid as much as we can is active humidifiers. Anytime the humidity in the setter drops below the set point and humidifiers are being activated, that water that is being sprayed inside the machine by a nozzle has to evaporate, and around such a nozzle, such an active nozzle, that water needs to evaporate, and that will take away energy and it will cause a local cold spot which will be sensed by several eggs in that area, and those embryos will simply lag behind in development and might then also be in ovo vaccinated at a too early embryo stage and then not get proper immune response. So we should make an incubation program that is minimizing the activity of humidifiers, and part of that is to create an environment of inlet air to the setter which contains enough water to avoid that the humidifiers have to compensate. The incubation profile is the last factor that I would like to mention. As I mentioned before, incubation temperature is the driving force behind embryo development. So if we are running the machine on a temperature profile, an incubation profile which is rather low, then also the embryo development will be much slower. And when I incubate eggs at too high a temperature, the incubation process will be faster. And this means also that embryo age is not necessarily the same as embryo stage. And that is why it is important, if you want to do in ovo vaccination, to not just focus on age, but to make sure that you stage the embryos and that you check if the vaccine is being delivered at the proper position inside the egg, being the amnion or the embryo itself. Okay, it is time to summarize this hatchery talks. In ovo vaccination is an excellent way of mass application of vaccines to individual embryos for early disease protection. However, we have to make sure that critical success factors are taken seriously, and hatcheries who are not yet doing in ovo vaccination and are interested to start doing it, they might have to optimize their hatchery management. And of course, hatcheries who are actively applying in ovo vaccination have to make sure that they keep their hatchery management in the proper way to make in ovo vaccination a success. Thanks for watching this webinar. Please visit the knowledge section of our website for articles related to this subject. The link to this webinar replay and the handout of this presentation will arrive in your inbox soon after this webinar. And last, but certainly not least, we are looking forward to welcoming you at our next webinar soon.
Royal Pas Reform, for the highest number of best quality chicks.